Thank you guys for listening to us. We're going to be discussing timing of genetic counseling. Should this happen before or should this happen after treatment? Neither of us have disclosures. So objectives, at the end of this talk, participants will be able to discuss medical management recommendations for hereditary cancer syndromes relating to breast and or gynecologic cancers, and recognize the impact of genetic testing on patient care. So what is genetic counseling?
So, whether this is in a setting of a certified genetic counselor or if the center has chosen to use physicians or RNs to do the genetic counseling, it's important to understand that there are definitions of what should be taking place during pre-test and post-test counseling. Definitions were placed out first by the National Society of Genetic Counselors, but since then, this definition has really been incorporated with NCCN guidelines as well as the Commission on Cancer. And so one of the most important things is to obtain a detailed family history. So this really goes beyond just asking the patient if there's any family history of breast or ovarian or uterine cancer. And it's this family history along with the patient's personal health history that allows us to perform a detailed genetic risk assessment. So over and over I've seen patients where they maybe have only had BRCA testing, but it's so important that someone who can take that family history and go beyond just these common gene mutations and determine if the patient maybe needs additional genetic testing for more rare conditions or even some of these moderate risk mutations. I think it's also essential to guide patients through the testing options and decision making, letting them know ahead of time whether this may or may not impact their medical management. Is this more maybe just for family member risk assessments? And talking them through some of their anxiety about testing. There's a lot of misconceptions out there about genetic testing and how it may or may not impact the patient. Obviously, we're going to have to work to facilitate that genetic testing, understanding what laboratories offer testing and what testing is available, explaining those results and the potential medical management options to patients, and then really working that genetic test result into the multidisciplinary patient care. So when we talk about NCCN guidelines and other guidelines out there, there are guidelines as to who should receive genetic testing and genetic counseling, but in particular, NCCN guidelines are very ambiguous as to the timing. They don't set out to tell us when testing should occur.
SGO and ASCO in, I think, August of 2017, so relatively recently, came up with consensus recommendations, and these are somewhat ambiguous as well. As you can see, they say pre- and post-test counseling by a trained cancer genetics professional is optimal, but they understand it's not available in all practice settings, and this is one of the biggest limitations. And they address that saying increasing access to genetic testing is an important priority to balance with resource availability. They go on to say, and I think this is important, that providers who choose to order testing themselves should be able to interpret those test results, apply those results to care, and be prepared to initiate cascade testing, recognize situations in which they require input from genetic professionals. So if you're going to order the test, know what to do with it is kind of the take-home point there. Again, they're still sort of ambiguous about the timing of the pre-testing.
And just to clarify, cascade testing is when we take the results of our proband or our initial patient and recommend who else in the family needs to have that testing. So we're talking about cascading through the family to identify all high-risk members.
And ideal scenario in a perfect world, the patient will see a physician after a cancer diagnosis, and that physician has the time to discuss genetic testing options. The genetic counselor is available the same day in an ideal world, that there's no financial impact on patient. Again, we're still talking ideal world here. The patient isn't overwhelmed, isn't too anxious to actually have this discussion. It'd be great if a test result was available within 5 days. And the patient is able to make treatment decisions quickly based on the results of the test. The patient also needs to understand the diagnosis and the recommendation for the testing and how that's going to impact their care. So typical scenario, more commonly, I guess in our practice, and we are at the Mitchell Cancer Center where we have a genetics counselor, so our typical scenario is quite a bit different than a community doc or other cancer centers. But our typical scenario is we have a patient diagnosed with cancer, presents to us. We discuss if it's recently diagnosed ovarian cancer. Oftentimes the patient is so overwhelmed with anxiety, planning either their primary treatment, surgical debulking, or neoadjuvant chemotherapy, that it's hard for them to really have an additional discussion about genetic testing that could impact, possibly their own treatment, but also, impact their family and the cascade testing like we discussed.
So I also wanted to talk about availability of genetic counselors or these professional genetic experts. Just a couple years ago, program directors, where we have these master's programs, were really given the challenge of increasing the amount of genetic counselors available in the United States, because as of 2 years ago, for every genetic counseling student that was graduating, there were two jobs available. So it just speaks to the fact that we don't have enough of these professionals out there. And so when it comes to a typical scenario, Dr. Jones already said it's different from one center to the next. Do you have a genetic counselor available? Are they overwhelmed and it takes a month to get out into them, a patient into the genetic counselor available? Or do we need to think outside the box and maybe have someone who's trained, even though they didn't get their master's in human genetics, or even using some companies? And I'll talk later about companies that are available to provide genetic counseling, either pre and or post-test. So Dr. Jones also mentioned that there are some barriers to reaching this ideal scenario where patients are offered and accept and get genetic testing before treatment starts. Again, with the availability of genetic counselors, I already mentioned. Also, we had to think about the financial impact. So a lot of these patients, when they're tackling a cancer diagnosis, I know at least with our center, there's a good number of patients that don't even have health insurance or only have Medicaid. And so the cost of testing could be seen as a barrier to the patient, which we try to overcome. I personally work with a lot of labs to make sure that the patient is getting the testing done for free, if not at least for less than $100. But then also, a lot of these patients can put two and two together and they realize, if I'm suddenly going to be offered not just a lumpectomy, but bilateral mastectomies, and do I have to have a BSO at the time of my surgery? Am I going to be able to afford this if my insurance isn't picking this up? One of the things that we see with Medicare in particular is that they don't pay for the prophylactic surgeries. So they might pay for the genetic testing, and they might pay for, like, let's say, the ovarian cancer treatment, but they're not going to pay for bilateral mastectomies in a woman who has Medicare and has a BRCA mutation. So we kind of have to think long term with these financial barriers as well. And then the cost of reimbursement for counseling in some centers.
I think another interesting point is that we have, in an uninsured population, to tell them to get, if they ended up with a diagnosis of a genetic mutation that puts them at high risk, to get on insurance, an insurance plan in the future is going to be much more cost prohibitive for them. So that's something to think about. Also, barriers are just, it's sort of a rapidly changing recommendations as far as who to test and what tests are available. This is kind of constantly evolving. As of this year, more tests have been available to the public. We'll touch on that here briefly. But even for a general practitioner to know, that all ovarian cancer patients, the recommendation, that's pretty easy. Uterine cancer, do you screen all uterine cancers? Yes. All uterine cancers under 50, the recommendation is testing, or through a detailed family history that might pick up on patients that you want to screen. And then again, what tests are available, what companies are offering which tests, how much do those cost, what can they afford, and what do the results of each company's readout actually mean?
So when we look at who to test, we will show a slide specifically for NCCN guidelines for who to test with the BRCA genes. But I wanted to kind of pose a question to Dr. Jones is, just as kind of the front line, the one who recognizes whether or not a patient should be getting genetic counseling and genetic testing, what's sort of your rule of thumb in terms of who do you send to a genetic counselor?
Well, thank you for asking. I follow NCCN guidelines. But again, like we talked, this is not, there's no mention as to timing of this referral, but NCCN guidelines do say that referral to a genetics counselor should be an individual with a personal or family history of three or more of the following. So this is a pretty large list here, and this can include up to a third degree relative. So a good family history, you know, can really be the entry into genetics referrals.
So, and then also more specifically, and I'm not going to go through each of these individually, but with BRCA1 and 2 testing in particular, we're certainly looking for any of those individuals who are diagnosed at or before 45 with breast cancer. If they're diagnosed before 50 and have other factors, such as another family member with breast cancer, more and more we're seeing in these guidelines, including men who have had prostate cancer, so if there's a family history of prostate or even pancreatic, or if there's a limited family history. Earlier we had a talk where they were referring to the triple negatives, so certainly anyone before the age of 60, but again, more and more, we can certainly consider those females who are diagnosed with a triple negative after 60. And then most recently was really using those tumor profiling tests to determine if a patient might have a germline mutation. And NCCN finally came out and said, yes, anyone who's hasn't had germline testing yet, but tumor testing does show a BRCA mutation, we need to go back then and do germline testing to see if it was actually germline, not just a sporadic mutation in the tumor. So Dr. Rocconi, our very next talk, will be harping on the utilization of molecular testing in gyn-onc cancers. But we just really quickly wanted to point out that with germline testing, this is really a mutation that a patient was born with, and it can be used not just for treatment, but also to talk about cancer risks in the future and those preventative measures, as well as providing family counseling, whereas the somatic testing, that's more for personalized medicine and treatment, and then the biology of the tumor can obviously change over time. It's not something that is throughout the lifetime of the tumor. When posing the question of what tests are available, so traditionally, let's go back 5 years even, we would really use that family history to help guide what genes exactly are we testing for. If there was no indication in the personal or family history, we wouldn't bother testing for some genes, but we would look more at single syndromes at a time. And we might be suspicious of more than just one syndrome based on the personal and family history, but we would take a stepwise approach where we would test those genes that were most likely to identify a mutation and then maybe order additional testing down the road as long as results were negative. One thing that has stayed true over time with genetic testing is that once a mutation is identified in a family, we usually order just single mutation testing. So it's important if someone claims that their mom already had genetic testing or their sister has the breast cancer gene or something like that, trying to get those results for family members so that we can kind of compare. Is it a mutation that's already been identified in the family? When they say the breast cancer gene, were they really talking about a variant of uncertain significance, which we know we really need to kind of ignore when it comes to medical management? And then, again, I can't stress enough, the family history is so important because there's sort of this common misconception that if there's a condition in the family, we're just testing for that. Well, what about, let's say, dad's side of the family? What if that looks like a Lynch syndrome family, even though mom has a BRCA mutation? We might need to do more than just single site testing if we're concerned about another condition being in the family as well. And then with the advent of next-gen sequencing, more and more genetic experts started using panel testing. And NCCN specifically says that the panel testing may be more efficient and cost-effective when more than one gene can explain a hereditary cancer syndrome. I would argue that almost anyone undergoing genetic testing should be getting panel testing. Whether you think of ovarian cancer being due to BRCA mutations, RAD51D, Lynch syndrome, plenty of other genes, you have breast cancer and a bunch of genes that are not only high risk but also moderate risk genes. And then even with uterine cancer, there can be multiple genes. So I do think that it's cost effective and more timely to go ahead and just order a panel test.
March 6, 2018, 23andMe announced it will offer testing for three mutations in the BRCA1 and 2 genes. And this move was officially sanctioned by the FDA. The interesting thing about this, it's only these three mutations, the Ashkenazi Jewish foundry mutations. I think this is really going to highlight the importance of genetic counseling. This company is not offering genetic counseling, it's offering a result. So, you know, a negative result from one of these three is not a negative result for all BRCA mutations. 23andMe has tried to address this, and they realize they can't provide counseling for every patient. They have provided a set of slides to educate customers on the distinction, but there's no opportunity for them to for genetic counseling through 23andMe. And a positive result. You know, what does a patient do with this result? There's no counseling. There's no relationship with a genetic counselor to sort of fall back on. You know, what does it mean to have one of these mutations if you're diagnosed with it? So, I mean, these are things to think about, this, you know, how to handle and maybe the ethics of direct-to-consumer testing.
I did want to throw in just sort of an anecdotal story here. So not only are negative results sometimes falsely reassuring, but positive results really aren't explained to these consumers in a constructive way. I actually had a patient when I was working in Virginia. She was in her early 30s and diagnosed with stage 3 breast cancer. And after doing her genetic testing with me, she called all her family members and explained that she had a BRCA2 mutation. Her dad actually went back to his 23andMe results and realized that he had had a BRCA2 mutation, that he had passed on it to his daughter. No one really took the time. Like 23andMe, they're giving results. They are not giving interpretations. And in fact, for any kind of interpretation, you have to pay another lab to help interpret those results. So it was just a very unfortunate event where the father felt a great amount of guilt because he didn't understand his 23andMe results. So we already talked about availability of genetic counselors or the lack thereof, financial barriers to patients, the rapidly changing recommendations, and really having the physicians or nurses rely on keeping up to date. I also want to point out one of the barriers that we don't have a lot of control over is the emotional state of the patient. There certainly can be anxiety regarding their diagnosis, and just I've had patients tell me, I don't want any more bad news, I can't handle that. Sometimes denial, a lot of patients who don't want to do testing never even make it to a genetic counselor in the first place. And then also fear of telling family members. I had a woman back in Pennsylvania who her family screamed BRCA mutation, but she didn't want to be the one to tell her granddaughter that there was a BRCA mutation coming from her. So it's kind of trying to overcome these barriers, but working with patients, I think, over time. Even if they don't do the testing before treatment starts, continuing to remind them that this service, this testing is available and could very well be helpful in the long run to them and their family members.
Right, but to be clear, we are still stressing the importance of pre-treatment counseling and possible testing if it's in a timely manner, because it can affect our treatment recommendations.
So one of the things I wanted to bring up was, you know, with all this stress and anxiety, Dr. Jones, do you see patients who are maybe those nervous Nellies that you never even get to the topic of genetic testing during that first conversation?
Yeah, and that's kind of what I was alluding to, that I do think that's probably more common than it should be, and that's one of the barriers that, you know, I feel like even in a perfect world, which we're trying to approach perfect there at the Mitchell Cancer Institute as far as timely initiation of counseling, it's sometimes something we can never visit. And I'd always try to drop the seed and say, we do want to do this. This is going to be part of moving forward. But you know, they can't hear it. They don't want to hear it. They want to get their surgery done, get the results, and start moving on before we can actually get them to see a genetic counselor. You know, I think overall a recommendation is going to be at least try to talk with the patient, whether they can hear it or not. They're hearing a lot of things at this, you know, cancer diagnosis when they first see us. You know, they're wanting to know survival statistics. You know, possible treatments. It is hard to try to get this genetics counseling component in, but I think it's really important to discuss that it can impact our treatment. So, as much as doing a physical exam and a history, really trying to get in to see a genetics counselor can affect both surgical and medical management options. So, make it clear that we are recommending that, you know, and that they can do what they want with that recommendation. But I think we need to be very clear that we recommend genetic counseling, It'd be great if we had, and we do, have a genetic counselor available for newly diagnosed patients so that we can talk about their diagnosis and then sort of hand them off to a genetics counselor who can talk a little bit more about the impact of what that means for them. We're going to go just through a couple, case examples about how genetic testing can impact both medical and surgical management. So just a brief scenario here, a 49-year-old female diagnosed with endometrial cancer, and let's, you know, maybe she got proper screening and she actually got testing and she came back as MSH6 positive, you know, for Lynch syndrome. You know, ways this can, you know, impact her is probably a referral for at least, you know, colonoscopy screening and possible discussion of a total colectomy due to her significantly high risk of a colon cancer. And then not in the upfront setting necessarily, but potential use of immunotherapy with MSI-high patients. And new approvals come out for really all solid tumors with MSI-high as candidates for immune therapy.
So quick question for you as a surgeon. If you go back to that 49-year-old with endometrial cancer, do you think it's feasible then to, let's say she's had a lot of surgeries in the past, has a lot of adhesions from scar tissue, would you offer then, if the surgeon says, all right, they need a total colectomy, would you be willing and able to do the hysterectomy and a total colectomy in conjunction with a colorectal surgeon at the same time?
Yeah, it's a good point, and I think that'd be worth discussing with the patient, for sure.
So with our next case, we have a 37-year-old female with endometrial cancer instead of Lynch. This one had panel testing and came back with a STK11 mutation. This would indicate that she has Peutz-Jeghers and is increased risk for multiple different types of cancers. So with this one, making sure that when you go in to do the total hysterectomy and BSO, also removing the cervix due to the high risk of a very aggressive type of cervical cancer in Peutz-Jeghers patients. Also consider performing the bilateral mastectomies at or after the time of her hysterectomy. And then it's so important in these young individuals to discuss colonoscopy screening. And then scenario three, if we have a 23-year-old female diagnosed with breast cancer, one of the genes we absolutely need to test for is TP53. With this patient, she has Lee Fermani syndrome due to a TP53 germline mutation. We would certainly want to offer bilateral mastectomies to this patient. And then again, impacting medical management, this patient really should not be getting radiation exposure if possible. We know that about 50% of Lee Fermani syndrome patients who receive radiation will get a second primary within that radiation field. Even without radiation, there's a very high risk for getting a second primary breast cancer as well.
And then our last scenario is a 42-year-old female who is diagnosed with breast cancer. Testing comes back BRCA1 positive. And just the importance of this, you know, as well when discussing with her, I think it's obvious we would offer her bilateral mastectomies, you know, offer her, you know, prophylactic BSO, bilateral subingual oophorectomies, but also in a BRCA1 patient, having the discussion of, you know, the potential increased risk of a, you know, uterine papillary serous cancer, and offering actually a hysterectomy in addition to the bilateral subingual oophorectomy at the time of surgery. And then it's good information to know with the new PARP approvals, you know, down the line if PARP inhibitors could be part of the therapy. Clinical trial enrollment, good point.
So just to wrap this up, so we've talked about our typical scenario. We've recommended that patients at least be offered genetic counseling and testing before treatment starts. But where are we going in terms of future directions? I think that it's going to be very important for healthcare providers that are, again, that front line of identifying patients who need genetic testing to keep up to date on those rapidly changing indications for testing. But there's been more and more talk about doing population testing. So Mary Claire King, who identified the BRCA mutations, has been arguing for years that all females over the age of 25 should be getting BRCA testing. So there might come a day and age where by the time someone is maybe diagnosed with cancer, they'll already have had genetic testing done on a population screening basis. And then in terms of the lack of genetic experts out there, there is a City of Hope training course. So if a physician or a nurse would like to take that training to just provide more you know, comprehensive genetic counseling pre and post testing, that's available. There's also telegenetics. There are companies out there like a company called Informed DNA. Not that I'm, you know, saying one company over the next. I don't have any disclosures there, but there are companies out there that offer telegenetics. And then also there's almost always genetic counselors employed by the laboratories that are being used for the genetic testing. I do think that eventually genetic testing will become cheaper, so that won't be as much of a barrier, and we'll have faster turnaround times, maybe not ever 5 days, but right now it's still about 2 to 3 weeks to get genetic testing back. And then as genetic testing and counseling becomes more standard of care, then people are going to hear about it more. Right now, I've had plenty of people ask me, what is a genetic counselor? What is genetic counseling? They have no idea. But as more and more people get it, I think it'll take away some of that anxiety that revolves around getting the testing and getting those results.
All right. We'll open the floor for questions. Comments?
So I do have this discussion with every single patient I see. Most don't bring it up, so I bring it up at the end of the session. With health insurance, we do have a couple laws in place that say that that health insurance cannot use genetic testing to discriminate in any way. And then also laws that say that genetic test results can't be considered a pre-existing condition, so that helps protect those who have not had cancer yet and are looking to be more proactive. And those laws are separate from the Affordable Care Act. So luckily, even if the Affordable Care Act leaves, we still have these protections in place for health insurance. Now, when it comes to long-term disability, cancer policies, life insurance, we do not have laws that protect us. And so I do ask a patient to kind of think through, if you don't have life insurance yet, and let's say you're still, particularly if you're young and don't have any major health issues, should we maybe get a life insurance policy in place first, just in case there is a mutation there? Or I'll talk about it with, let's say I have a 75-year-old who just found out she has Lynch syndrome. All right, well, maybe your family members need to talk about their life insurance policies before pursuing genetic testing themselves. Yes.
I'll comment briefly is the variants of unknown significance are becoming significant.
Correct.
As we move forward, and I think we have to be careful with those, how we interpret those, that it's not a negative result. As far as retesting, I'll let you speak to retesting.
So I think if you're a provider or sending someone to a provider who's doing genetic testing, it's really important to keep track of all those patients and their results, and not only that, but what tests they did. So if they had just BRCA testing, when I came on in 2016, I was encouraging all the physicians, send those patients to me who had BRCA testing but had negative results, because now we have panel testing. In a lot of cases, I can get the panel done for free because these labs are looking to gather that data and show the efficacy of doing panel testing. And in fact, we do find, like for instance, there are plenty of families that look like they have BRCA mutations, but when we retested with the panel, they actually have Lynch syndrome. So it's important to keep track of who had what and what their results were so that we can go back as genetic testing improves. In terms of variants of uncertain significance, I'm kind of glad you asked this because it's very important that you choose your labs wisely. There are labs out there that they're just more concerned about pumping out results and not so much about how are these results going to impact the patient in the long run, whereas the main labs that we tend to use for genetic testing, they are committed to continuously not only doing research themselves, maybe even functional studies on these variants of uncertain significance, but also doing almost annual reviews on these variants to see what has been published, and then contacting us so that we can contact the patient once we know, is it a harmless, benign gene change or is it really pathogenic? So using those labs that we know are going to contact us as they get updated information. But with the panel testing, when panel testing first came out about 5 years ago, we had to tell patients about 40% of patients will have a variant, at least one variant of uncertain significance. So it became more and more part of our conversation with the patient.
Thanks, guys.